Very good afternoon, one and all gathered here. I would like to thank the Trendo 2019 team for giving me this opportunity. My topic of discussion today is functional imaging in neuroendocrine tumors and paraganglioma. First, a brief introduction. What do you mean by functional imaging exactly? It is the imaging of physiological process or biological function of the organs. It may be the secretory process, it may be the receptor expression status. We administer a radionuclide which emits gamma rays, and we administer it along with the functional pharmaceutical which will follow the physiological process or function of the organs. It is done by two important modalities. One is with gamma camera, through which two-dimensional planar imaging can be acquired, and three-dimensional SPECT imaging, single photon emission computed tomography, can be acquired with gamma camera. And everybody know that technetium-99m is the workhorse radionuclide for all gamma camera procedures. And another important hybrid imaging modality, which is PET-CT, positron emission tomography. It is a positron emitter which is combined with the organ specific radiopharmaceutical and injected into the patient. The positron which is emitted is captured by the PET-CT machine. These are the few positron emitters, F18 and gallium-68, which I'll be discussing. Both I'll be discussing it today. So when a positron emitter is injected, it emits two positrons. Your positron annihilates with electron in your body, and two gamma rays are emitted, which is imaged by the positron PET-CT machine. What does PET-CT exactly does? First, the whole body CT will be acquired, and then the patient will be moved inside a ring of detectors where the PET will be acquired. Finally, it will be fused with the softwares available, and then a fused PET-CT image you can see. Okay, we'll move on to the topic, neuroendocrine tumor imaging. As we all know, neuroendocrine tumors are arising from the neuroendocrine cells dispersed throughout the body, derived from the neural crest. It can originate from the endocrine glands as well as the endocrine cell clusters present in the GIT, respiratory tract and pancreas. And they all belong to the amine precursor uptake and decarboxylation system, which makes it amenable for functional imaging. It can concentrate and secrete wide variety of amines and peptides, which differentiate those into functional and non-functional subgroups. And majority of them arise from GIT. Some percent, 25% arise from bronchopulmonary, and few arise from unusual sites. They are very slow, indolent, slowly progressing tumors, so they are diagnosed when they are locally advanced most of the times, when they are diagnosed when they are inoperable most of the times. These are some of the functioning tumors, as we all know: carcinoid syndromes and insulinomas, gastrinomas, VAPomas, which are known by the syndromes what they produce. So why functional imaging is so crucial for NET? NET usually it presents in a very small size. Initially, the anatomical location is so variable, and it has a very low metabolic rate, which makes it amenable for functional imaging. And one of the characteristic feature of NET is the expression of somatostatin receptors in high quantities, which makes it amenable for functional imaging. This is the WHO classification for pancreatic neuroendocrine neoplasms. One is well-differentiated neuroendocrine neoplasms, which is of three grades, grade 1, 2 and 3, which is classified with the help of proliferation index, Ka67 index and mitotic index. And the other set is poorly differentiated neuroendocrine neoplasms, which are called as neuroendocrine carcinomas. And the other subset is mixed neuroendocrine or non-neuroendocrine neoplasm. I'm putting this classification so that I'll tell about these in the further slides. So what are these somatostatin receptors? Somatostatin is a naturally occurring peptide in the body which regulates the release of so many hormones. It has a low metabolic stability in the body. It is present in different normal organ systems. So because of the low metabolic stability, a synthetic analog octreotide has been developed, which has a longer biological half-life and stability. So So this is the difference between naturally occurring somatostatin and synthetic octreotide. The T half of synthetic octreotide is 2 hours. Naturally occurring, it is 2 to 3 minutes. So these somatostatin receptors are G protein coupled receptors present in so many normal organ systems in the body, which are classified into 5 different groups. These somatostatin and the octreotide differ in their affinity for these receptors, which has very high affinity for somatostatin receptor type 2 with low affinity for type 3 and 5. So these are the normal human tissues in our body which contains this somatostatin receptors. So hybrid functional and anatomical imaging like SPECT-CT, PET-CT, they play a crucial role in staging, restaging, assessing the somatostatin receptor status, grading of this NET with the help of those receptors. And why to assess these receptor status? To make decisions on most appropriate therapy regimens and prognostication of the tumors. So what is somatostatin receptor scintigraphy? First, it started with gamma camera, SPECT-CT imaging. The rationale behind this is high density of expression of these receptors by neuroendocrine tumors, mainly receptor 2, 3 and 5. Majority of the neuroendocrine tumor, they express somatostatin receptor type 2, although the low amount of other receptors can also be present. So these are the neuroendocrine tumors which has high expression of the receptors, which includes almost every neuroendocrine tumor we know. Some of the unusual tumors like Merkel cell carcinoma, small cell lung cancer and meningiomas as well. And there are other tumors which has low expression of these receptors. They don't originate from the neuroendocrine cells but can express receptors. So if we target these tumors, it can help in therapy decision of these tumors. So with SPECT-CT, how it started? First, it started with iodine-123 octreotide. This was the first radio tracer introduced for SSTR imaging, which is somatostatin receptor imaging. But it was very difficult for labeling this, and it had some inherent difficulties, like there was significant bowel activity, which made the interpretation for us difficult. Then we moved on to indium-DTPA octreotide, which was conventionally called as octreoscan, used before. It had some advantages. It was excretion route is kidney, so GAT was not taking up much. Delayed imaging is also possible. It cleared rapidly from the blood pool. So that was being used till the new tracers, new PET tracers were introduced. It was imaged with the help of SPECT-CT with gamma camera. This is the image of gallium indium octreotide, which shows some lesions in the liver and a tumor in the pancreas, metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. So everybody would have heard about this also, technetium-99 high-nictoc. Then from iodine and indium, we moved on to technetium-99 high-nictoc, which is a high-nictoc is it's a chelating agent used. The toc is nothing but an octreotide. High-nic is the chelating agent. Technetium is the radionuclide. So this had a better image quality, high target to non-target ratio. And another tracer which is approved by FDA was Neotect. It was approved for the evaluation of pulmonary nodules in case of neuroendocrine tumor metastasis. So this is the high-nictoc image, which shows a lesion in the liver. A little bit better resolution than the previous image what you saw, the indium images. This is also done with the help of gamma camera. So now we move on to somatostatin receptor PET-CT. So what are the PET radiopharmaceuticals? Gallium-68 DOTA conjugated peptides. They got approved by FDA in 2016 for imaging of neuroendocrine tumors. There are three type of radionuclides. One is gallium-68 DOTA TOC, one is 68 DOTA NOC, gallium-68 DOTA TATE. So what is basically the difference between all these traces? Overall, they brought a very good improvement in spatial resolution and increasingly being used. PET-CT itself is a modality which has a better spatial resolution than SPECT-CT. So gallium is nothing but the positron-emitting radionuclide which can be produced with the help of germanium-gallium generator in-house in this laboratory wherever we work. And DOTA is the chelating macrocyclic chelator, and TOC, NOC, and TATE are the oncotypes in where slight modification of amino acids are done so that the affinity for the somatostatin receptor differs. So affinity profiles, this DOTA TOC, DOTA NOC, and DOTA TATE can all bind to receptor 2 with good affinity. Gallium 68 DOTA NOC has good affinity for somatostatin receptor 3 and 5. DOTA TOC can bind to receptor 5 better. DOTA TATE has 9 times more affinity for somatostatin receptor 2. So that we use this DOTA TATE peptide in the case of therapies of neuroendocrine tumors. So what are the clinical indications? As I mentioned prior, neuroendocrine tumors, they express high density of these receptors. So they are mainly used for staging, localizing the primary tumors. They are used for follow-up of the patients to detect the residual or recurrent disease. And to determine the density of somatostatin receptors, patients with somatostatin receptor positive tumors are more likely to respond to octreotide therapy, which we call as theranostics, a diagnostic imaging agent paving way for the radionuclide therapy, which we call as theranostics, selecting the patients with metastatic disease for radionuclide therapy with therapeutic radionuclides. Monitoring response to therapy is a controversial issue because once the tumor gets de-differentiated, it loses its receptor. So since it is a receptor-based imaging, it is a very controversial thing whether it indicates a therapy response or loss of receptors, so it should be dealt with caution. And as I mentioned before, there are some tumors which expresses low density of receptors even though not originating from the neuroendocrine cells. So in those tumors, it is not an initial functional imaging modality, but we can use it for assessing the receptor status for treatment of those tumors if no choice is left. So how it is distributed once you inject a gallium DOTA peptide? Normal uptake is seen in pituitary, salivary glands, thyroid, liver, spleen, adrenals, pancreas, and the excretory system. There are some pitfalls. Exocrine pancreas uptake is many variable and it can lead to false positive results. And another pitfall is normal physiological uptake in the sympathetic system, adrenal glands, which might interfere at times with the diagnosis of adrenal neuroendocrine tumors. This is a normal DOTA-NOC image which shows uptake in pituitary, adrenal glands, liver, spleen, and excretory system. So how to prepare a patient for gallium DOTA-NOC scan? As any scan, first we explain the procedure, we get an informed consent. We discontinue the octreotide therapy whenever possible and not contraindicated. But this issue is a controversial issue. We have observed good uptake with even though we have octreotide therapy also. So 1 day is recommended for short-lived octreotide molecules, 3 to 4 weeks for long-acting analogs. Many of the times it is not possible since the patient is so symptomatic. The best option is to perform the PET CT study just prior to the scheduled monthly dose of long-acting octreotide. And no need for fasting for gallium DOTA-NOC scan. And there should be relevant history and the tumor marker levels in recent history of chemotherapy and surgery and octreotide therapy. The activity which is administered for DOTA-NOC scan is, we talk in terms of millicuries. So it is like 4 to 6 millicuries, we usually say, of DOTA-NOC should be administered. What are the caution to be taken? We should confirm for female patients whether they are pregnant before the scan. It's a contraindication for pregnant patients to administer a radionuclide and get a scan done. For breastfeeding patients, appropriate injections should be done. Breastfeeding should be discontinued for at least 8 hours after the scan. They usually say for subjects under 18 years of age, it should be administered with caution if the benefit versus risk should be considered. Withdrawal of octreotide therapy should be done with caution if they actually tolerate it. What are the clinical applications in case of gastroenteropancreatic NETs? It is extremely useful for imaging of GEP NETs and because they classically contain large number of somatostatin receptors which are distributed both at primary and metastatic sites. We can go through some literature. Usefulness in diagnosis, staging and restaging. In the large meta-analysis, it showed 93% sensitivity and 91% specificity. So it should be considered as first-line diagnostic imaging method for suspicious thoracic and a GEP NET. It's basically a one-stop shop solution because It's a whole body imaging modality, it is a receptor imaging modality. It can tell about the primary as well as the metastatic sites. So it's better if you, on the first choice, if you have a high clinical suspicion, to go for a functional imaging. Where I did my post-graduation, we did a prospective analysis of 109 patients. Again, it showed a high sensitivity of 78% and 92.5% specificity for a primary tumor and 100% specificity for metastasis. And it supports in changing the management in 30% of the patients. So in any day, it is better than a conventional imaging modality for detection of both primary as well as metastasis. And the detection rate of contrast enhanced CT was lower than the TOTNOC PET CT for both primary tumor and metastatic disease. This is the image which shows a increased gallium uptake in the primary tumor in the stomach. There is one focus in the liver, as you all can appreciate, but this lesion was not seen in CT. Since the before the anatomical change happened, the receptor changes have started showing up, so there is uptake only in the PET but not in the CT, which upstaged the patient as stage 4 in this case. Again, this is one more classical case of insulinoma, which has a pancreatic head lesion and multiple malignant insulinoma with multiple liver lesions. One more case of gastrinoma stomach post-surgery, with now coming with raised serum gastrin levels, we found a periportal lymph node which was producing the gastrin and recurrent symptoms for him, where you can see the arrow in the periportal level. You can, you can show up, the uptake will be just shown up as soon as you see the image. Suspected NETs, a patient with clinical histopathological biochemical suspicion of NET, but diagnosis is not obtained even after OGD scopies or conventional imaging. DOTA PET CT has high sensitivity and specificity. We did a retrospective analysis of 164 patients based on all these findings, clinical, biochemical, and imaging findings. Again, it showed a very high sensitivity and specificity and accuracy. 90% accuracy in patients with clinical signs and symptoms, 86% with raised biochemical markers, and if they have a suspicious imaging finding in conventional modality, the sensitivity is again, obviously it will be high. So this patient came with raised serum chromogranin and abdominal pain. You can see a focus of uptake, small focus of uptake in the duodenum, which was proven to be carcinoid after biopsy. And again, this patient came with recurrent episodes of hypoglycemia. There is a classic pancreatic tail lesion. The first image is the PET MRI image. Classic pancreatic tail lesion without any metastasis. Insulinoma was proven after surgery. Another entity, metastatic neuroendocrine tumor with unknown primary. Patient present with lot of liver lesions, lot of metastatic lesions, but conventional imaging modalities cannot localize the primary. 2 to 4% of carcinoma of unknown primary has this NET group. And we did a study in 20 patients, prospective study. We were able to localize the primary in 60% of the patients. The most common primary site was midgut, and gallium DOTNOC PET CT helped in localizing metastatic disease, additional sites of metastatic disease as well in lymph nodes and bones. Usually CT shows a lymph node, they have a size criteria for lymph node, but in gallium DOTNOC PET CT, even though the lymph node is very small, it's 0.4 centimeters, if you see the uptake, it becomes significant. That is the difference between a functional imaging and a CT imaging. So it considerably changed the management in 15% of the patients. This is an image showing multiple lesions in the liver. We found a small focus of uptake in the gut loop, in the ileum, with a minimal wall thickening, which was not appreciated in CT much. It was just glowing. The uptake was just shown up. So it's a proven neuroendocrine tumor of ileum post-surgery, after that post-biopsy, sorry. One more case, you can see a small focus of uptake in the ileal loop, in that image, with multiple liver lesions. All these neuroendocrine tumor with unknown primary, the primary remains very small. So next indication is selection of therapy and monitoring response. Since they express lot of receptors, targeting those receptors for therapy becomes the important modality in management. And the uptake of these analogs depends upon the cellular differentiation, as I mentioned before, depending upon the Ka67 index. This Ka67 index is nothing but the marker which expresses the rate of cell growth. So if the cell is growing very slow, if it expresses more number of receptors, the Ka67 index remains less. If the cell is growing very fast, it means it is de-differentiated, it has lost its receptors, and the Ka67 index is very, very high. So well-differentiated NETs with low Ka67 index have high tumor Dotanoc uptake. The patients with poorly differentiated tumors, they show high FDG uptake. So in this way, it can be used for monitoring response to treatment in GEP NETs also. This is a case of rectal NET. This is the FDG image where we are not able to appreciate any uptake in the liver lesions and the primary lesion. But this is a DOTA PET image for the same patient which shows multiple liver lesions and uptake in the rectal lesion. This is another case of duodenal malignancy where the duodenal lesion is not picking up any uptake in the this is Dotanoc PET CT, which is not picking up any uptake in Dotanoc PET. When they did the biopsy, it came out to be a poorly differentiated carcinoma. So in this way, we can prognosticate the tumor as well. If there is no uptake on DOTA PET, we can say that it is a poorly differentiated tumor. So the prognostic ability results from its inverse association with the cellular proliferation. So we did a study where it showed the histological grades to be significantly associated with progression-free survival on multivariate analysis. The high SUV max, what we say a quantification parameter, that correlated with the progression-free survival on multivariate analysis. Another entity is carcinoids, where it is graded into typical and atypical carcinoids. Typical carcinoids, they show higher receptor expression and gallium uptake and significantly less uptake of FDG than tumors of higher grade. This is a case of first image is FDG image where you cannot appreciate any uptake. Second image is Dotanoc image where you can classically see high uptake in a case of typical carcinoid. And one more indication is when a lung is collapsed, conventional imaging cannot show any tumor localization. Dotanoc can show tumor localization even though the lung is collapsed with the help of the receptor imaging. What are the I will show you a few slides on clinical applications on paraganglioma and pheochromocytoma. So these are the neuroendocrine tumors arising from the adrenal medulla, which are functional and non-functional.